We'll do a quick summary and then we'll break for tea. Anyway, tea is not till 3:30. So we have time. So this brings us to the last activity that we want you to do in this course. Okay. So let me talk about a few things. We talked about going from teacher-centric classrooms as well as teacher-centric MOOCs to from learner-centric classrooms to how to create a learner-centric MOOC. So what we have finished are these first two parts of conceptualize and create. We have not done too much of the conduct because that's a little bit far away. Once you have created, only then we are going to start worrying about conducting a MOOC. Okay. And just to recap, this was the figure that we saw in the first session. And now, hopefully, this figure makes a little more sense as to how the classroom activities are mapping onto your MOOC components, LCM components, where learning dialogues are videos plus reflection spot, LBDs are exercises with customized feedback, okay, learning experience interactions are discussion forum focus questions with response and reflection quizzes, right? So we don't expect you to have everything at your fingertips right away, right? So that's an unreasonable thing to expect. So what we'll do is, let me skip this slide and we'll quickly go to the takeaway. So since you can't remember everything, what is the most important thing? What is the one thing that you remember? Okay, just write down. So each of you, when I create my own MOOC or online course, okay, don't think of it as something very big. When I create one module, when I create one lesson for my own online course, okay, what is it that you have learned from this workshop that you are going to take back with you? So two things. One is I should do something, and the second is I should not do something. Okay, give you 3 minutes to write down and then we will type it. Okay, I think what you want to say is you should repurpose, right? So repurpose and create MOOC only for new courses, not repeat creating MOOCs for existing courses. Essentially, that's what you mean, right? Okay. Okay, some people from the center. Repurpose, okay. So I am just going to do repurpose plus one. Okay. If you have the same point, it's fine. You can just say plus one to something. What about time duration? Yeah, give a full sentence. I should do. I should keep in duration. Keep it short and sweet. Tha na kidhar to. Okay, I'm going to put a plus one there. Okay, anybody else?
Background and behavior of students.
What about it?
Actually, I have followed a recent paper in edX. There was a course, 150,000 students are registered in that course. There is statistics. It was found that in that course, the students are from primary level to PhD levels.
Okay.
So when we are making our MOOCs, so we should keep in mind that transmit the knowledge from basic to higher level.
Okay.
And you should follow the behavior of the student in discussion forum, what they want.
Okay.
What their expectation from this MOOC. So you can change your mind time to time.
Okay. So I'm putting it down as scoping. You have to do the scoping. You have to create short courses which are basic to advanced. All right. Anybody else? Yeah. Should not mein ja raha hai. Okay, let's move to should not.
Should not use any resources without taking permission.
Okay, very good.
don'ts, okay, I should not use resources without taking permission. Okay. In should, okay. Yeah, it's okay. We can go back and forth between these two points. No problem.
But I think one point is to close the loop. Use analytics so that the person who's teaching, the teacher also comes to know.
Okay.
Like, Samir sir was telling a very interesting thing to me. They run statistics and found out how many percentage of students are doing the graded activities, how many are not doing the graded activities.
Yeah.
And therefore, you can retweak in the next edition when you roll out.
Okay. Okay, so teacher gets feedback, I am writing it down, it's, we haven't covered that as part of the workshop, I mean we haven't done anything about talking, any activities about that, yeah. Anybody else still wants to be on the do's?
Yeah, I should experiment for learning, peer learning,
okay, incorporate peer learning, okay, don'ts. Don't use videos, don't use resources without taking permission. What else?
Should not deviate from topic.
Deviate from topic means what? Deviate from, let's be a little more precise. Learning objectives, yeah. Okay. So, now we are in the don'ts. Yeah, okay. Don't go outside boundaries. Outside course. Is that valid? No, it's not exactly working out. I'll put it in the do's instead. Yeah, it's part of the scoping principle, yeah. Okay, I'll put it as scoping plus one. You know, you should stay within the course boundaries. Okay, don'ts. Don't change the deadlines. Okay. But you are the ones who ask for extension of deadlines.
Sir.
I am happy to keep the same deadlines.
I should not do without a proper understanding of demand in market.
Ah, okay.
Means I meant to say if new technology is coming, like IoT or nanotechnology, so I have to take consider of those technology while designing book, and I should not go with outdated or some old technology while designing.
Okay, so yeah, so this is a valid point. So there are two aspects to it. One is the market demand, right? So market demand is like, you know, are there takers for it and so on and so forth. That's a valid point because you are going to spend a lot of effort in creating these videos, and you know, if either there are no learners or if learners are not willing to pay for it, both of them is not a good thing. The second thing that you can read instead of market demand is also learner needs. So what exactly, so maybe there are learners, but are you giving them what they need, right? So we spent a lot of time trying to, you know, decide how we should run this this particular workshop, and then finally we decided that look, all of yesterday we will do mostly principles and theory, and today we will do mostly practicals. We are not very keen on that idea, but we still finally said that that is what will suit this audience the best. For some other audience, you might want to do it differently. So that's the key point. Okay, any other don'ts? Yeah.
Don't show the answer of the graded quiz after shows answer after deadline.
Don't show answer of, so okay, this is an operational issue. Before.
Stop copying.
Okay, so actually I am going to bypass this one so that people don't WhatsApp the answer to their friends and others give the same answer. Theek hai.
We should not focus much on ICT.
Okay, don't focus. Instead, what should we do?
On the content.
Focus on ICT. Okay. Instead, focus on the content.
Don't focus only on ICT.
Okay. That is there. Use resources without. So it's okay to say the same thing again. You know that basically, it's not necessary that each of you should take away non-intersecting items.
I should not basically only video and only text.
Okay. Video, text. Okay.
There should not be any factual errors. Mistakes in the presentation.
Factual errors. Why didn't we talk about this at all? In this workshop? Yeah. So we had an assumption in the first slide, right? We made an assumption that you are not going to have factual errors. Okay. Anything else?
Don't be passive in students' interactions.
What does that mean?
There's whatever they raise for the queries, we need to interact and clear the doubts.
Okay. Okay. Fine. Okay. So let's quickly see whether it matches with where do these fall in the buckets that we have created. Okay. So we haven't made a list of don'ts. I mean, don'ts are actually the negative of the do's, but these are a few of the points that we would like you to keep in mind when you go away from this workshop. So one of which is create learning dialogues for the goal of delivering information, right? Each LED must focus on one concept that can be explained in less than 10 minutes. Okay, reflection spot must be a task related to that concept, either at the recall or giving an example or a simple application or an opinion level, right? How many of you have got this point, understood this, feel reasonably confident that you can apply it? Okay, very good. Every LED must be followed by one or more related learning by doing activities, right? LPD activities should make the learner interpret or apply the concept in a LED. How many of you have got this point? If you haven't got, we'll do the workshop again, starting now. Right? Okay. All right. Design assessment questions both in the format of MCQs as well as open-ended tasks. It can be done even in online courses. Okay? You have seen that you have participated in them as learners. Now as instructors, like when you did the RCAs and so on, which were open-ended. Now as instructors, you also know how to, since you have seen how we did that, you can do the same. Give constructive feedback for learners' responses to LBDs and assessments. Right? What was the activity you did today which dealt with this point? You did an activity today in the morning. Scripting is not this point. The last point. Give constructive feedback for learners' responses to LBDs. Peer review is written there. You wrote the feedback that you will give for your multiple choice questions. Okay, you wrote different responses. Okay, we did that, right, in the morning?
Yes.
Okay, right? So that is this constructive feedback. Don't just say right or wrong. Very good. Okay. Exploit the power of peer learning. Design learning experience interactions and collaborative assignments. I think you have experienced this a lot in the FDPs and the 601 and all those other earlier courses. In this workshop, we have not done too much of exploiting the power of peer learning because of time. Otherwise, we would have had you look at each other's LEDs, you know, learn from each other and so on. But this is a point which you already know. Explicitly address diverse backgrounds and different abilities of learners by designing learning extensions. I think somebody mentioned that. How to find LXTs? Okay, that also we did an exercise on finding LXT for your topic. Okay. All right. And then don't be passive to learner actions. Many of you have said that. Broadly speaking, you want to explore and utilize the technology affordances to address your pedagogical needs.
So we
forgot to put repurposing. Yeah. All right. Okay, let me put it now. Don't create a MOOC unless it's actually necessary. That's a good way of thinking about it. Okay, repurpose to the extent possible. Okay, it's not very well stated, but we'll live with that. Okay, so now in the remaining 10 minutes or so, let me call all the instructors down, including Yogi. And if you have any specific questions or any questions, we'll take questions together. Yeah?
Actually, we have a 3-credit course for runs for 40 hours in a semester. And if you want to break it into videos and MOOCs like this, with one video length not more than 10 minutes, and again there are quizzes and many activities in between. So how do we fit the entire thing in a semester's pattern, or some part of the syllabus we make it into MOOC, some part into conventional? Is it like this?
Yeah, so unless you have to create a complete MOOC, complete online version of it, don't do it. So what we suggest is take some part of it. And you can start with even 1 week. So you create an online version for 1 week where students actually do the activities at home, they do the LEDs, LBDs and all. And then when they come back and reconvene for the face-to-face meeting after that week, you can in fact ask some recall level questions, reflection questions about that week. So you can start with 1 week this year, do 3 weeks next year, and then even stabilize to only 30 or 40% of the course. So this sort of blended format is possible.
Even 30-40% is also success.
So it depends why you are doing it. Success in what sense? What do you mean? What does success mean to you?
I mean, actually, it will be best.
Yeah.
Ideally, what I understood from now is any engineering subject when taught in a MOOC way or so practical way, interactive way, will be the best way to teach. But because of time problem, we cannot convert the entire semester's course in entire MOOC. So we break it into some part we make it into MOOC as much as possible. So in that perspective, I'm saying.
So some part you convert to a learner-centric MOOC, and the rest of it you convert to a learner-centric face-to-face classroom.
Okay.
That will be successful.
Without taking much time, I thank you IIT Bombay for providing everyone such a wonderful opportunity to have the gems like you. I want to ask a question from Dr. Yogen, that you have shown us a video that has some multiple choice questions embedded in that particular video. You have fill in the blanks. So where that data is going to be stored?
Yes.
So that the assessment process that we have to do, there should be some sort of storage. So I was confused about that. So can you let me know where we'll be getting the data?
So first of all, these kinds of activities are not for final assessment. It's for the learning purpose, but still data is there. So okay. When you log into your system, and you will see for each H5P activity, there's a report section.
Okay.
In the report section, you can see who have attempted that and how many marks he get. So the detailed report is still not there, means how many marks is okay, but which activity
actually,
in the whole thing
we
he
just
has
need
done
to know something. Whether the students have attempted the
yes that part is available
is
yes that is
just
available.
To ensure that
that is available for all Moodle, Drupal and WordPress.
Okay, thank you.
So my question is especially to Yogendra sir, that give your comments on the market scenario related to MOOCs in the Indian market.
Market scenario related to MOOC. If I would have known it, means I would not have joined IIT Bombay again. So the thing is, it is very difficult to protect your material in a digital era. So as soon as I upload my video on internet, they are pirated. In an hour, I find them on various pirating websites. Even I find it on IITB's links also. So if you think about in that, so when you convert it into active learning strategies, then it is very useful. Means I keep experimenting with my videos. So I have a video series on Excel 2010. It is 2016 now, so means Excel 2016 is available, but still we are running a course on Excel 2010. It has 34 videos. All 34 videos are available on internet for free. They are available on YouTube. Still, students buy our videos. Okay. Before buy, there's a checkbox. Means even if they, before they pay, there's a checkbox that says that I agree that I know that all the videos are available on YouTube for free. Still, I am joining this course. I have made that button. Still, students buy the course. Although the cost is not much, it's only 250 rupees. But still, why they are buying it? Because they know there are some activities there. There are some exercise files that they will download, they will solve their work, and they will ask the question to the teacher, and teacher will respond them, not only on online platform, but also on WhatsApp. So they want immediate feedback, and for that they are ready to pay. I'm sure the cost can be increased for different courses. Say artificial intelligence courses, even if you will make the videos free, you can still charge for the service that you are providing. So I think there's a value attached to it, but the videos piracy is not possible to stop that.
Yeah, so I'll just add one more point. I think activities and services are the two most important points which see, the content is always free. It's the activities and the services for which you can charge. And if you are an institute, one more thing that you can charge for is the certification. So that's another reason why institutes go for creating MOOCs.
Is there any standard format for the declaration of plagiarism?
To avoid the copyright?
Okay, this is regarding declaration of... I think there, first of all, now what eOutreach does is they make you sign a form as soon as you register. So there's a standard template. So by agreeing on to, so it's like I agree to the terms and conditions, which you blindly do for many of the online applications. Just make it explicit that I agree to make all the contents. So for example, as soon as you go back in your email, you will find a email with a consent form attached to it, where you have to agree that whatever materials you have created and put it in our Google Drive, we will be able to use it for research and other purposes. So that is one way of doing things. So any submissions that you do, okay. See, help of others.
So partners may do the material from others' website.
So to some extent, we will be able to see. It's not 100% foolproof. Let me tell you outright. It's not 100% foolproof. We use things like Turnitin and other plagiarism detection softwares to check for plagiarism. But even over there, we see that not all sites may have been indexed by Turnitin. Or see, what if the image and videos are already, so the YouTube link is, so Turnitin cannot go into YouTube video and see what the person inside the video is seeing. That is not possible at this moment. But yeah, so 100% foolproof thing is not possible. But some of the instances where we have found out that how we try to minimize it is, the more you have it for peer review. So for example, in this FDP also, we have had peers reporting to us saying that two people are using the same site, two people are using exactly the same resource. The websites itself is same, or somebody is using my, so one of them found out that another peer used her own resource as a submission for flip classroom activity. Now these things, only because she had created that particular flip classroom activity, she knew it. Otherwise, it may not have been possible. So yeah, there are some ways we are trying to use exploit technology. So this is where we try to exploit technology affordances in these kind of segments, but to whatever limit technology allows us. Otherwise, we expect more technology advances that will help us in.
So I'll just add one point. So the simple way of doing this is to, when you're using somebody else's resources, make sure that they are OER resources. We are not using anybody's proprietary resources. And when you're creating resources, make them available back in OER. Okay, then you are fine. If somebody is taking resources that you have created and, you know, you're making commercial use of it, you know, I've heard of places where the entire, there is no instructor for a particular subject, but it's running with, you know, NPTEL videos and IIT Bombay X videos and so on, okay, let it go on. So that's really not so much of a concern. You only look at yourself. I will use OER resources. Whatever resources I generate will go back into OER. And then that should be more or less sufficient for you. Okay, any other questions?
For online course, for open-ended questions, one way of assessment is a peer
assessment. That is a one method. But there is a some, even if you are giving the criteria for the assessment, there might be some issues regarding the peer assessments. So how to overcome that at the back end side as an instructor or as a faculty? And second one is there is any automatic or plugin available for open-ended questions assessment on the Moodle or somewhere?
Open-ended plugins, I don't know. I mean,
open-ended questions process.
Yeah, so there are there are program checkers are there even for open-ended text box entry. There are checkers which will do some kind of syntactical match with model answers. Okay, but there, while you can use them, what is more reliable is the peer assessment, because there is learning for both parts of the peers.
That is there, but after that, even if you are considering those as a part of your assessment.
Yeah, so it depends a little bit on how much credit and weightage you're giving those activities. So if you're saying that my entire final exam, which is worth 30%, is going to be created into one of these activities, it may not be a very wise choice. You know, if you need the final exam marks to rank students and so on. On the other hand, a lot of these open-ended activities, while there is some credit associated with it, as an instructor, we design them largely for people's learning. Okay, that's point one. Secondly, if you are running an online course for your class, for a small group of students, then you can consider manual grading. I mean, if you have 35 or 50 students, you can give a rubric, you can have self-assessment, you can have peer assessment, but you can use the same rubric as a teacher to give scores. The rubrics can also be used for self-assessment. This is something we did not mention much, but they are the first level of check that the learner can provide himself or herself. And if the weightage of the grades is less, then people will actually use them. And you know, everybody wants to see how they are doing with respect to some criteria. So the purpose of the rubrics are to make the criteria very clear and explicit.
So I understand where this query is coming from, FDP peer assessments. See, so we don't have that much advanced NLP, but one thing is there in platform, in all platforms, there is a provision of staff graded assignments. So the next upgrade of IIT Bombay X, so wherever there are queries, we can have staff look into these uploads or assessments and do an evaluation by the staff, and that goes into the grade. But at a massive open online scale, I don't think it will be a suitable solution. Yeah.
So lastly, once we'll create a particular course for a MOOC course for a topic, or where is a platform where we can publish all these things? Okay. Or on which platform that we
have? Actually, there are many platforms available. So those who can bear the amount, Teachable.com is the best platform. You will get the interface equivalent to Udemy, Coursera, edX. Okay, and the cost is not much. Okay, so Teachable.com is one option that is very good.
Okay.
That depends on. So they charge on the basis of active students. So you have to go there and check the pricing. Okay, and second thing is, so if you do not want a brand name. Correct. If you want to host on their site and want to use their name, then there is no cost. You can upload your courses, run your courses, students can join it, and they will get 10% share of what students pay. Correct. If you don't want to gain money from that, then you can make your system, make your courses available for free. And if you are not branding your videos, then there's no charge. Otherwise, there is charge. For others, I would suggest to either use Moodle or to use any WordPress-based LMS. There are many. I personally use WP LMS. Okay, but there are many and they are very good. So if you will go for WordPress-based LMS, means you will Google it, then you will find a lot of good LMSs and you can choose any one of them. And the good thing about them is that they are very cheap. Means the WP LMS costs me only 6,000 rupees for a year. So I have to pay 6,000 rupees every year. It's not a big deal. Okay, and I can install it only on one server.
So no space issues and?
No space issue, yes, correct. So you have to host a server and This is how it works. Yes. Yes, yes. It's your system. So you can run as many courses as you want. There is no problem with the money, whether money will go with someone else or not. So you can set up your own system on that. And that is video-based LMS. So Moodle is not video-based. But the other LMSs that I am telling you are video-based LMSs.
Sir, from programming courses, how can we embed compiler into the learning by doing activities?
There are many paid services that allow you to do so. Just search on Google for online compiler. And yeah, I checked it 2 or 3 days back. The price was very low. Means I have to deposit 1,000 or 2,000 rupees for 10,000 queries. So if you make it available only to the students who joined your courses, then I think you can use it for 2 or 3 years. So that's not a big amount.
Obviously, we will follow all the principles while creating the LMS. My question is, do you have any rubrics for assessing the videos or LEDs, LBDs, what we are going to create?
Not yet. Okay. So we are in the process of, first we'll create some constructors. So we'll all make it available on that site. I mean, if you go there now, you'll find our previous workshops, the site which is up there. This current workshop's material will appear there. And also we'll create some constructors which will help you systematically create LEDs. At the same time, we'll put up some checklists and some rubrics for you to self-evaluate your LEDs. That's a very good point. And we will do that in due course of time.
Thank you.
Okay. Is there anybody else? Okay, so that brings us to the end of this workshop. Let me just ask one last question. How many of you are here for the certificate? Because of the certificate? Nobody, right? Okay, so the certificates are ready. You can pick them up from the registration desk on the way out. All right? Yeah.